You are in the right place if you're here to hear a talk about secure operations with DSC and Apache Cassandra, right? Welcome again to DataStax Accelerate. We're happy to have you here. Who here was at the boot camp yesterday? That was awesome. I really enjoyed watching you guys go through those exercises and sort of putting Constellation through the paces. So my name is Ben Coverston. This is Carrie Cox. The person who was going to introduce us got double booked, so we get to introduce ourselves today, which is okay, right? Not the first time. Today, like I said, we're going to talk about deploying DSC and Cassandra in the cloud. So let's talk about this for a minute. So it's Sunday night. You get a page. A researcher who you know pretty well because you follow him on Twitter, did some searches, did some open source intelligence on your company, and they found what looks like your production data on a paste bin out on the internet. Do you know what you lost or what you could have lost? What's in your production databases? For a lot of people, it's your crown jewels. The thing that makes your company valuable, or some of the things that make your company valuable, think about your customer lists, the things that you've sold your customers. Perhaps there's data in there about people's activities, maybe some proprietary data about your line of business, right? Maybe the thing that gives you an advantage over other companies that are out there. So how did this happen? How did they access your data? What access rights and privileges do they have? Is it an insider attack? Are they still there? Who do you notify? Is the data protected by a regulatory statute? Do you need to notify a regulator, a customer, your board of directors, your legal counsel? Have you considered how you're going to respond? Do you even have an incident response plan? Is it written down? Have you tested it? All of these are important questions. So at DataStax, our security program, in our security program, we have a mission, and part of that mission we've defined a canon, right? And as part of that canon, we've got a couple of tenets, right? Oftentimes when a security breach happens or we discover a vulnerability in a server or service that we use, we have to ask ourselves a couple of questions. Like if we disclose this vulnerability, who does it put at risk? So if there's an active vulnerability, as we found in the past, in a widely used service, we have to first ask the question, if we disclose this immediately, will it cause more damage, right? So our first obligation is to protect society, right? Our second obligation is to protect our customers. Our third obligation is to protect our employees. And finally, we protect our shareholders. So as we think about security and as we think about the things that we're doing, we have to consider who is affected by breaches and who is affected by the vulnerabilities that we may discover or the vulnerabilities that we may release out into the public if we're not careful. Of course, your data is valuable. There's an interesting scene or a funny scene in the movie Sneakers, which many of these slides come from, where they go out and they do some dumpster diving to find people's trash, right? And a lot of our data we might look at and we're like, this data isn't very valuable. But if we take little pieces of data from multiple places, sometimes that data becomes valuable. You can make connections, you can put things together. Compromised data can damage trust in you, your product, your company, and trust in society as a whole. Database security itself is a known quantity. Like, how many of you guys have deployed a database somewhere inside your company? Usually it's layered behind multiple firewalls, right? It's something that we've been doing well for about 20 years after the age of the mainframe when we started doing SQL servers. When we started deploying SQL servers, we started building these multi-tier applications. A lot of times we had middleware, application tier, right? Every single one of these tiers having a firewall between itself and a database application further in the stack. It often looked like this, right? This is like your typical or classical application stack that we've been building, again, since the advent or since the popularity of SQL Server or SQL databases or relational databases, right? So we've got the SQL Server on the top of the stack. and the firewall, right? And between the firewall and the next tier, we've got our middle tier or our application tier, or our middle tier, or maybe our application tier. A lot of times there are multiple. We generally call these not three tier, but N tier applications, because sometimes you had an internal API, and then you had another firewall, and then you had an external API, and these are the things that your customers consumed. And beyond that, you had websites and mobile applications and things like that. So our databases were generally well ensconced, layered behind multiple things, right? And this was good. And it was a pattern that we knew and that we exercised well. And then, you know, people started asking questions about, you know, what happens when our database server goes down? How do we get redundancy in a system like this? So we built these master server or these sort of master and replicated databases. So you'd write to a single master, and then you'd replicate your data over a WAN link or maybe to another building, and your application stack was over there too, right? So if one went down, you could fail over to the other side. These were good architectures. They worked, if not a little bit wasteful, because oftentimes your passive side wasn't really doing anything. So I saw a lot of servers go into the wood chipper after not being used after 10 years. Because they were rebuilding the entire thing, and they just had a bunch of stuff that was in passive mode for a long, long time. So this is stuff we know. I'm not telling you anything new right now. So I'm going to invite Carrie up to talk about, so why are we talking about DSE security if database security is something that we already know about today? So thanks, Carrie.
Thanks, Ben. So as Ben mentioned, this traditional database architecture is a well-trodden space. We're very familiar with this and how it typically is deployed. So with relational database deployment, let's review a typical scenario which we have for the geographical distribution of relational database management systems. So RDBMs don't behave as one might expect. Typically, applications are not geographically constrained. So bear in mind that most relational databases, such as MySQL, Oracle, PostgreSQL, are not specifically designed for this type of deployment. So moving on to an active-active architecture, where Ben mentioned there was an active-passive, we like to call this the unicorn. This doesn't exist in the wild. For most NoSQL database systems, architecture does not exist. So this then leads us over into the CAP theorem, CAP being consistency, availability, and partition tolerance. And partition tolerance in this context means the following: the ability of a data processing system to continue processing data even if a network partition causes communication errors between subsystems. And so SQL databases are not very partition tolerant. And so again, this slide emphasizes the fact that that is to say, relational databases with an active-active architecture do not really exist. So network segmentation also influences the viability and feasibility of relational databases. So most databases have at least a few network segments which we cannot 100% rely upon. So set network segments may go up, may go down, they may be dynamic or active VPNs. It all depends upon how it was architected. And also, network availability zones are typically located in a single structure, in buildings, and may be physically next to each other. And so network segments are often geographically dispersed, whereas SQL databases typically exist in a single cloud. And then finally, a network failure is indistinguishable from a data center failure. So the question arises then, is it possible to cluster SQL servers? Within a cloud, there are a few options. And though clustering can help with your availability and also your recovery, it won't be of much help if a region goes down. So at least not with the typical relational database structure. So then what is the solution? So with DSE, or distributed databases for replication, we can ideally set up a multi-regional replication or asynchronous replication. And for this scenario to function, partition-tolerant multi-region replication is then required. And DSE, Apache Cassandra, makes this possible. So some of the first principles of security, I'll give you a moment. Oop, let me go back, pardon me. So hybrid solutions. As pointed out today by our CEO, Billy, DSE and Cassandra can accomplish this. So however, we need to consider what was being proposed. Asynchronous replication means we're potentially creating a hybrid cloud or hybrid cloud WAN for our database. So we're distributing data across multiple regions or several regions geographically dispersed, and we're expecting the data then to replicate within milliseconds. That's something that other data, SQL databases were really unable to accomplish prior to this. So let's talk a little bit about the first principles of security. I'll give you a moment to read this. Let me just highlight the highlights. So there's no chance of their having a conscious glimpse of the truth as long as they refuse to disturb the things they take for granted and remain incapable of explaining them. For if your starting point is unknown and your endpoint and intermediate stages are woven together out of unknown material, there may be coherence, but knowledge is completely out of the question. So think about that as it relates to databases. So databases are typically three or four layers within the intranet, as Ben pointed out. So we use what's called layered security, otherwise known as a layered defense, where you have the middleware, you have the upper tier, and you embed your databases deep within your network. So this principle describes the practice of combining multiple mitigating security controls in order to protect your resources and data. So real quickly, we switch genres here. Can anyone name the movie this scene is from? Hackers, yeah. So which is better, sneakers or hackers? That's kind of a flame war in the making right there. But anyway, I digress. So why is this movie and this particular screenshot important to what we're trying to explain? Well, your data needs to be protected, whether it's at rest or it's in transit. We need to make certain that foreign agents cannot view, compromise, modify, read, access, whatever, to any of your data. You need to make certain that this is secure. So DSE and Apache Cassandra do offer the following to ensure security: transport layer security, TLS, transparent data encryption, and secure authentication and authorization. So how then is your data protected? So you and your IT staff, including security, need to know how your environment is architected. How has it been crafted and constructed? So how it was done 20 years ago is not necessarily applicable to how it should be done today, especially if you're thinking in a distributed data model. So know what your risks are and how your environment is now unique and how it needs to be changed or modified. So here's some questions you need to ask yourself. Do you and your team understand what needs to be protected? Do you know what data needs to be protected and where it lies? Why did you create the architecture you currently have, and how does that need to be modified now? And are there any cryptographic barriers with controls set? And what compensating controls, if any, are now in place to secure this new set of data? So understand that the security is proactive. This is the first step. And this can include sensors, monitoring, logging. Can anyone name the scene in the movie Sneakers? What's happening? It's Robert Redford, by the way. He's trying to slowly move through a motion sensor location. So he's being monitored and he's trying to move extremely slow so he won't trigger this. This is what's happening in a lot of networks. This is what a lot of malicious agents are trying to do, slowly encroach upon our networks and infiltrate and extricate data. So examples of sensors monitoring and logging include IDS, IPS. We have different types of monitoring systems. There's a lot of proprietary and open source monitoring systems. And then for logging, you have Splunk, Elk, ElasticStack, the list goes on. So there's numerous open source as well as proprietary applications that we can discuss outside of this presentation, and we'd be happy to entertain those questions as well. But understand that security, when it comes to distributed databases, is still requires a lot of sensors, monitoring, and logging. So next, understand that security is also reactive. And reactive security includes the following concepts: auditing, alerting, and you need to have something such as a SIM, or a security incident event monitoring application. Something in place that will alert you if it detects malicious agents or malicious activity. And a reactive security, it states that the security is constantly being updated and improved upon depending upon the feedback that you get from customers, from your personnel, so on and so forth. So returning to the earlier slide where we displayed multi-regional distribution. So with DSC, the situation differs from traditional databases. Users deploying distributed databases cannot rely on legacy architectures to protect the data. And distributed databases then rely on disparate networks to transfer data to and from points A and B. So again, let's discuss the difference between stateful and stateless content delivery systems. So distribution is quite easy if you don't have to deal with state. And stateless distribution uses asynchronous replication, and other CDNs do this quite well. However, stateful services is what sets DSC apart. It makes a global database possible. A stateful CDN service is by nature distributed. Most NoSQL databases subscribe to this model and are optimized for this type of scale-out structure. And stateful services provide multiple homes for the data. So a former big data buzzword that you may have heard used to be velocity. And rather than updating across networks twice a day, which we used to do, so we'd perform a backup from the active for the master to the slave, we need to now have updates happening every hour, every minute, every second, in milliseconds, no less. So for example, you have a user, and this user's traveling from the US to Europe. And this user subscribes to Netflix. And he's been watching, or she has been watching a movie, the latest movie that's out on Netflix. And then she travels, or he travels over to Europe and wants to instantly pick up that same profile and pick up right where he or she left off on her movie. When that person logs in, they need to have that profile immediately available. Does that user have to wait a few hours for the profile to be updated across the ocean? No. He or she expects to be able to pick up right where he or she left off. And that's what Apache Cassandra provides. So this makes global distribution feasible. And so the difference here is that we're not so much concerned about protecting the assets from exposure. So what does that mean then? So how do we protect our data from being exposed? So we expose the right data in the correct manner. And how do we do that? Well, transport security is an all-important issue here. You can't run a multi-region distributed database without being confident that the data is securely protected. It's more difficult to protect multiple bastions rather than it is to protect a single database behind multiple firewalls. So this latter example requires SSH bastion hosts sitting on small public networks, using jump host to access the database. This is something that most system administrators are familiar with. So, what is our responsibility now as we start to implement a distributed database? We've decided, yes, we're going to take on DSC and Apache Cassandra. What is our responsibility? What do we need to do? Well, a security team needs forewarning and training prior to any type of incident. And incidents will happen. So they need to be appraised and be on board with how we're going to build and implement a distributed database model. And most security teams will be unfamiliar with this type of distribution. There may be also policies, procedures that are in place that would kill DSE or Apache Cassandra if implemented right out of the box. So you may not be the security pro, but someone on your team or someone in security needs to be and needs to be appraised of how it is you're going to go about engaging and implementing DSE. So the motto here is engage with your security team early. And most likely they haven't seen anything like this. They'll be used to having a knock and having everything under a single pane of glass. And you're going to have to enlighten them as to how Apache works versus other relational databases. And so talk to also to your network team about the architecture. So network is just as important to ensuring the security of DSE as is any other security. So if your network pipes are too small, there will be issues. And your network may require IPsec enabled. In layman's term, network architecture is just as important. And so like the security team, the network team needs to be appraised early of how things will be crafted and architected, and they need to, you need to have their buy-in. So real quickly to summarize, let's move on to the holy trinity of security, the CIA model. Many of you are familiar with it already. First one is confidentiality. So DSE provides multiple differentiators here, which allow you to provide encryption both at rest and in transit. And so if you go to docs.datastack.com or any place on the datastacks.com website, under documentation, you'll find a plethora of information regarding the implementation and maintenance of these security models. So authentication and authorization are also important aspects, and DSE provides several authentication methods along with role-based authentication to ensure data is protected. Next, we have integrity. We're making certain data is not changed while at rest or in transit. So backup and recovery is what ensures data maintains its integrity. A replica is not a backup. And I'm sure we can all relate to it, numerous instances where backups were performed but never tested. And I won't go into detail or provide you with stories at this time, but I'm sure we can all relate to it or have some instance from our own past and our own career where backups failed or else data was lost. So in summary, test your backups, make certain the recovery process is in place, and any heroic actions on your part might be able to save you, but data corruption is still possible. And you need to determine the failure duration, take into account the nature of the distributed database, which can lessen the severity, and be mindful of your MTTR, your mean time to recovery, and test all possible failure scenarios. And then finally, availability. In order to make certain that data is available, you need to test your service level agreements, or SLAs. Statistically speaking, going from a 10 to 100 node cluster, the opportunity for failure does increase by an order of magnitude. However, recovery can be 10 times quicker or slower depending on the number of nodes. So as you design your systems, check your MTTF and your MTTR. So more nodes can mean more failures. So build your nodes and node sizes and plan for recovery. So with that said, I'm going to pass the time back over to Ben.
Thanks, Gary. All right. So this is the most controversial slide in my deck. I'm not too serious about being anti-VPN, but VPNs can cause a lot of pain and trouble as you design your networks. And as we move into the cloud, we have more options to peer our networks together, right? So just keep that in mind as I'm talking here, right? Personally, I don't like to use VPNs for most things that I use. I'm migrating off to other things, but secure transport's still important as we move forward. But the whole idea here of building a secure database with DSE is that We're not talking about building a single stack in a single data center anymore. We're not even talking about building a single stack in a region in your cloud provider spanning availability zones, which are really just buildings, like three, like if you look at like a satellite picture of US East or US West, what you have is a bunch of adjacent buildings in that region. Well, we know that power failures happen and failures are bound to happen in a system like this. And so we want to span into different regions and insulate our, and even into different continents and insulate ourselves from those types of failures. Ultimately, what we're trying to build is a multi-region, multi-cloud database so that we are not locked into, we're not locked into a single vendor, we're not locked into a single region, and so that our services can be available for all of our customers all of the time. Now, how do you connect these different networks together? So one of the things that you should do, and one of the things that you should endeavor to learn if you don't know how to do it right now, is how to peer VPCs together in different cloud providers, right? How do you connect two disparate networks together? And how do you get them to communicate? How to configure the routing between those? AWS has a number of facilities that can allow for more diverse types of communications, one being Direct Connect, for example, in AWS. Look at Private Link. Look at inter-region VPC peering. In Google Cloud, Cloud Interconnect, Cloud VPN, and peering over there as well. And on Azure, there's ExpressRoute, there's Azure VPN Gateway, and virtual network peering that you can look at. All of the cloud providers also have a way that you can peer their network into your on-prem network, because we're not just talking about multi-cloud, we're also talking about hybrid cloud where there's a component locally. So consider this as you move forward. So you laugh, right? But one of the things that we have to consider is that not everyone should have access to your database. Not every application should have access to your database. So when I was showing you the layered application tier in our legacy applications, this concept is not changing as we move forward. What is changing is this thing happens in more places, right? But we still want to segment off access to the database and only allow access to the database from the applications that need database access. Typically, these are your internal applications and your internal APIs, and not your application tier, for example. So in addition to segmenting things off physically and through firewalls, you can also create roles in DSE and prevent people from having blanket access or roles from having blanket access to your database. This is, you know, sort of things that we've been doing in relational databases for a long time and shouldn't be different from a conceptual perspective from what you've already been doing. Just remember to keep doing the things that you've been doing well in the SQL database world as we move forward. There's another aspect here, and that is that you have to operate your database similarly to the way that you've operated databases in the past, right? There is a server administration component, right? So from an operational perspective, you have servers to maintain. You also have a database that you still have to maintain. And those two things may require different skill sets and different people. So consider least privilege in that case. As I build out distributed databases, one of the things that I have to think about is I have a database in Dublin, and I have a database in Singapore, and I have a database in US East. And I need to be able to provide network access, or at least administrative access, to my operations people so that they can maintain and patch servers, for example, right? Hopefully we're moving forward and we don't have to patch our servers and we're doing blue-green deployments and stuff like that. But the reality is that somebody needs access to that network, right? So oftentimes what we'll see people doing is they'll deploy a small public network and put a bastion there and allow access into the private database network from a public bastion. And then cut off the ability to do things like lateral movement inside that internal network, right? So really think about how you want to structure your database when you start moving into this globally distributed database world, because it's different. Your database administrator is no longer sitting in the same building as your database, right? Sometimes not even the same continent. And sometimes you have administrative teams that live in a follow the sun model. There's somebody up all of the time and they could be anywhere in the world. And this idea of inside the firewall and outside of the firewall doesn't really exist in any physical way. So in addition to that, consider your access patterns, right? So if your database goes down in one region, do you want your middleware to cross into another continent and talk to your database on the other side of the world? Sometimes latency can cause problems with connection pooling and all kinds of other stuff. So you may want to consider, you know, when your database is down or when you have a partial failure in one region, just to let that region go for a little while until it fully recovers, and then service your customers in another region that you may have. So consider some of your access servers, how you're going to protect your servers, how you're going to use bastions, how you're going to use whitelists, and how you're going to flow data through the system in the case of a failure. Right? Finally, and this is the big point here, is that symmetry is your friend. Try to build your system so that they're consistent across different regions. One of the ways that we got ourselves in trouble with SQL databases is because we started doing crazy things or unnatural things with SQL databases, like sharding them. I don't know if you guys have ever seen the slide that I think it was published in like 1998 or something like that, where eBay was like, this is how we scaled. And they were like, we took our catalog, we put everything that started with the letter A in one SQL Server instance and letter B in another one, until they had 26 SQL Server instances, right? That's not how we want to build things. We don't want special cases. So with DSE, as you distribute your data across regions and across geographies, try to build your application stack in a way that's consistent, so that your firewall rules are all the same, so that your stack looks the same, and you can manage it in a consistent manner as you go from one place to the next.